Hello, everybody. My name is Patrick Farrell. I just flew in from a family vacation in North Carolina, so jet lag's starting to hit me pretty hard right now, but I'm very happy to be here. Thanks to Guillermo, thanks to Record Union for having me. I couldn't be happier to be here. Big fan of what Record Union's doing. I'm very happy that they're a member of our organization. And yeah, I guess some background. I originally from North Carolina. If y'all know where that is, I'm very impressed. Beautiful little southern state down in North Carolina. But I moved to New York 8 years ago to work in the music business. I got my start at Capitol Records, worked in the promotions department, working alternative radio. Moved on to doing A&R. After that, that was about 5 years total between the two departments. And then I went over to Spirit Music Group, which is a indie music publisher in New York. Consulted for them in their A&R department for about a year. I quickly realized that I wanted to try some things on my own. So I started managing bands. I managed a band out of Chicago by the name of Pet Lions, a band out of Nashville by Bad Cop, Penicillin Baby, and then a New York artist by the name of Francis Cohn. And then I got this wonderful opportunity to work for A2IM. A2IM is the American Association of Independent Music. We're a nonprofit trade organization representing the independent label community in North America. Just in a nutshell, I'd like to say we're fighting the good fight on behalf of independent labels in a very major label-dominated society. Nothing against majors. There's nothing wrong with them. But there's very creative independence out there that should be treated the same way that majors are. So let me just cue thing up here to kind of give you an overview of what we do at A2IM. So yeah, here we go. I'm just going to kind of stand to the side. As I said, we're a nonprofit trade organization representing over 390 independent labels in America. We are trying very hard to cross the 400 mark. That's what they brought me on board for. My day-to-day is dealing with our record label members. We have label membership and we have associate membership. Associate membership is anybody that relies on the independent label community for their business to thrive, such as Record Union. All your DSPs like Spotify, major distributors, anybody that has a vested interest in creative content, they join us on that side of the field. But I specifically deal with independent labels. I try to educate them. I try to provide business growing opportunities for them, networking events. But our labels membership, it crosses every genre you can think of. From your heavy hitters such as Beggars Group, XL, 4AD, Young Turks, we have Matador, we have Big Machine, which is Taylor Swift's label. We have Mass Appeal, Run the Jewels. I'm sure you've heard of those guys. We have quite a diverse membership. And then on our associate membership side, we have over 180 partners, including Record Union again. And we are a proud member of the Worldwide Independent Network. Our mission, I'm just going to read this over for you because it can get a little cluttered here. But A2IM works to improve the business of its members in the independent music community through lobbying, commerce opportunities, networking events, member education, discounts to industry events and services, and by messaging special offers to our members. We are uniquely positioned to serve as a central voice for a diverse community of independent labels operating within the United States. Our organization represents independents' interest in the marketplace, in the media, on Capitol Hill, and as a part of the global music community. I think a lot of why our members join is for our advocacy efforts, because if we're not fighting on their behalf for equitable terms, who is? We know that in America there are three major labels. There's Universal, there's Sony, and there's Warner, and they have a lot more money than our independent labels do in terms of lobbying efforts. So we're trying our best to make sure we're getting the same deal structures, fair terms, which is an uphill battle, but we're trying. And I think we're getting there. Our objectives, kind of what I just spoke about, equity and leadership in commerce, growth in international partnerships and trade. We do a lot of export missions. Last year we did one to Brazil. We did one to Asia last year as well. Providing business opportunities through member networking is a big part of what I do. For example, we had a CBS Radio Summit, again, very major label dominated, but we had a 45-minute window for our labels to come in and present their priority tracks in front of nationwide programmers. Did the same thing for iHeartRadio about 3 weeks ago, we had members from Dimmock, which is Steve Aoki's label. We had Curb Records out of Nashville. We had 4AD, which is part of Beggar's Group. Hopeless Records, All Time Low. And then who was the last one? Pyramid Music, which is Avicii's label, who is a new member. They have an artist by the name of Victoria. I'm sure some of you have maybe heard of her. She's, I believe, from here. No? I'll work on that. access to media. I think that's one of the biggest issues with the major versus indie in terms of what's fair. As we've known over the years, the access to television and broadcast radio, the majors have a firm grip on that, whether it's, you know, getting regular plays on top 40 radio or alternative. We're trying our best to get all of our broadcast partners to know exactly what our labels are up to and have the chance to hear their music rather than just get force-fed major label material. And the last but not least, the government advocacy is a big part. My boss, Richard Burgess, he does a lot of our advocacy efforts, and that is a very complex topic, which I won't bore you with, but it's a heavy one. Let's see what we got next. Our board of directors, we have some amazing execs who have been working in this business for years, who form our board and help with our initiatives, especially on the advocacy front. We have Stephanie Alexa, that should be an A there, that's wrong. ATO Records, Alabama Shakes, I'm sure you've heard of them. Craig Balsam from Resident Tie, Glenn Dicker from Yep Rock and Red Eye Distribution, out of my home state of North Carolina. Very proud to have them. Amy Dietz and Ingroove, Dave Hansen at Epitaph and Auntie, Wilco, you probably heard of them. Andrew Kautz at Big Machine, that's Taylor Swift's label, which you might be shocked that she's actually on an independent label. She is distributed by Universal, but they are 100% independent. Universal has tried and tried to purchase them, and they've continually said no. Martin Mills, Beggar's Group, one of the most amazing human beings and smartest music execs I've ever met, the man responsible for signing Adele. Amongst many others. Louis Posen at Hopeless Records, Scott Robinson at Dualtone, who signed the Lumineers. Tom Silverman is an absolute legend. You know Tommy Boy Records, everybody from De La Soul to Naughty by Nature, legends. And then Darius Van Armen from Secretly Label Group, which covers Jack Jaguar, Dead Oceans. Who am I missing? Another one, but he signed Bon Iver. Amazing artist, as you know. And this is our team. We're a small team. We are a nonprofit, but we are growing. This year, Richard Burgess was announced our new CEO. Jennifer Massé has been with the organization for 7 years. She's worked in the business for 20 plus years, working at K7, amongst other labels. That's me. Marcus is our operations manager, Alexander Rosen is our marketing, and Cheryl Cohen is our jack of all trade and pretty much is the glue of our team. I look forward to what we have done in 2016. This is a big part of why we have membership. We do events at South by Southwest. We have a breakfast. We do executive one-on-ones for our members to meet with associate members, label memberships, to talk and find ways to grow their business. Canadian Music Week in Toronto, Music Biz in Nashville, Meetem is obviously a big one. Indie Week is our flagship conference that we have every year. This past year was our largest yet. We had over 820 of our members come in. We had foreign delegations from 20 plus countries. We cap it off with the Libero Awards, which is our annual award show. It's basically the Indie Grammys, which I don't like to say the Grammys because we're not trying to be the Grammys, but it's our way of celebrating our community and all the accomplishments over the past year. I'm going to show you a sizzle reel of that to kind of get an idea of what we're all about. The Latin Alternative Music Conference happened in July. All That Matters is coming up. It's a huge conference in Singapore. Mondo is a new festival coming up. It's essentially the new CMJ. Have some of you heard about CMJ in New York City? It's been going on for 20 plus years, but sadly might not be happening this year. But Mondo is coming in and giving it a stab. Americana Fest in Nashville, which Guillermo will be joining me there, and proudly sponsoring our reception. Thank you. Reeperbahn in Hamburg. The DIY Musician Conference is a conference put on by CD Baby, and that's their first year. It's going to be in Chicago. It's going to be great. ADE, which is Amsterdam Dance Event in Amsterdam. And then the LA Sync Up is an event we do. It'll be our second year of doing it. It's basically we get a ton of our label members and upwards of, I think we had 80 music supervisors last year, and it's just a way for our labels to pitch their music to everybody from supervisors at Netflix, ESPN, you name it. It's a great way to generate business and relationships. Let's see what we have next. And that's my thank you. But but let's go back. I want to show you the Libera Awards, which is our... this was our award show that we had in June. Like I said, it capped off our Indie Week.
Independent music and independent labels.
And the nominees are.
And the nominees are.
And the nominees are. On any given night, I'm sure, could have been any of them, but tonight, the award for Best Live Act goes to the Alabama Shakes.
Go Lippies, look at this room. This is a big one.
Look at that room, man.
We've been waiting 5 years for a Lippie. Thank you, everybody.
I mean, it's just great to be in a place with a bunch of sort of like-minded labels who are all putting out great music and working really hard to support it.
Yeah, this is awesome. Thank you very much.
Thank you to everybody. Big up. Into the Pit is slightly embarrassing for a man in his 40s to have to say.
It's been a little while since we've been in the pit. Not that long.
It's very humbling to be recognized by your peers, by an independent community we've been a part of for a very long time.
It's so great to work with you and to be part of that community, and thank you so much for this.
Incredibly important. About the community, it's nothing, isn't
it? Dance music's come a long way from the Jersey house that juiced up Guido's used to pound on me to the rhythm of. That's it. That's all for the jokes, I promise.
Independent music is running the game right now, really.
There's a lot more support for it, so I think it's the best time it's ever been.
Smarter, better, faster.
The growth of A2IM, the growth of the Liberas, the growth of independent labels around the world means it's a great time to be an indie.
And most importantly, I want to say independent record stores.
Thanks for all the indie guys out here, the indie labels, the indie artists. Y'all rock. Thank you, man.
And I want to congratulate all the independents. You're doing a great job. Keep doing what we're doing.
We started out independent, and we've stayed independent for 50 years. And I want to commit that we'll stay independent for the next 50 years as well. Thank you very much.
We did it in the broad daylight and had a much smaller crew, and therefore no one would believe that we weren't filming a porno.
You guys, that's our show. We're done.
So that's that's a very proud moment for our organization. I mean, you see all the labels and the artists that are part of our community. I'm overwhelmed with pride to be able to work with these amazing labels on a daily basis and have their voices included in everything we do, because they realize that we need unity in order to survive, and to not even to survive, but to enhance our business, to grow this business, to not go backwards in time, which a lot of the U.S. laws, I won't get into the politics, because as you know, I mean, we could spend hours talking about U.S. politics. Think about how slow they are with decision making. Just apply that to the music business by like 10, and it's just, yeah, we'll leave it there. But yeah, that's our community, and It's fantastic. And I think you look at that and people don't realize some of the most creative, some of the largest artists that are out there today are independent artists. And I mean, I just have a list here that I just wanted to share. I mean, as you saw, we have the likes of Radiohead, Taylor Swift, Arcade Fire, Alabama Shakes, Grimes, Run the Jewels, Bon Iver, Fetty Wap, The Lumineers, Mumford & Sons, Chance the Rapper, and most recently, I'd like to welcome Frank Ocean to the good side because he fulfilled his Universal contract and now he owns his own label. I need to have a call with him and get him to join our organization now. That's the next step. But I think at the end of the day, what A2IM does, it's a sense of community. It's just we have so many talented artists that we have to look after and make sure they're not being exploited. We live in a digital era, and I don't see the music business going backwards to a physical format. Yet we've seen vinyl has a reassert—it's a reemerged format. Sadly enough, vinyl made more. It made, I think it was about $416 million in revenue last year compared to about $320 million from freemium model on Spotify. That's a problem. That's a big problem considering how much consumption's on the digital front. I just want to kind of open it up to, I guess, what it is to be independent. I mean, there's a lot of ideas of what does it mean to be an indie artist. I think it can mean two things. In terms of the label side, I think it means that you own, it's fully owned. There's nobody else investing in your company, and if they do, they don't have a major stake in your company. There's a lot of JVs out there. You do 50-50 deals, say like Drake's OVO and Warner Brothers. That's a, you know, who knows the exact nature of that deal, but it's a JV. And I think if you own your company solely without a major financial backing, and then there's also the notion that if you have a less than 2% market share in terms of sales, you are an independent label. Collectively, the independent sector in America reports 36% of the market. And that's a significant chunk when you consider that there's basically three major labels that they're competing against. Globally, the Wind Network just announced that there is a 37.1% independent market share based on copyright ownership. That's a very significant stat, and it shows that we should not be treated any differently than a major artist, yet that happens. But I wanted to open the floor. Did you have any questions about independent labels in America, or yes, you?
Okay, I actually have two questions. First, I didn't quite get it about, you only represent American indie labels, right?
That's yes and no. They can have a presence outside of the US, but they had to have a US office.
Okay.
For example, Pios Records is a member and they're based in Belgium. They have offices all over the world, but they have a New York office.
Yeah.
As long as you have like KTEL Records, the famous 70s infomercial label. They are based in Winnipeg, but they have a New York office. So if you have a presence in the US, you can be a member of our organization, but it's due to our bylaws, you have to have presence in the US.
But I guess you have like collaborations with like European,
absolutely,
Swedish
like
labels.
AIM in the UK, we work very closely with AIM, and we work closely with all of our sister trade organizations. That's why the Worldwide Independent Network was formed, so all these trade organizations can come together and have a, you know, be at the forefront of discussions on a global scale.
Okay, my second question.
Okay.
Do you think there's a big difference, like being an indie label in the US and in Europe?
That's a very good question because I don't know much about European indie labels.
No.
I know, a great question. I would assume by nature they're very similar. And to me, what an indie label represents is that they represent artistic freedom. I see a lot of artists that go to a major and they have this notion that they're going to get a record contract. A year down the road, they were not the band that they were signed at a year before. I think the advantage of signing with an indie, while there are thousands, I think creative control, I think ownership, I think that's a huge part. Owning your masters is that's massive. And you go to a major and you see in the fine print on a contract, in perpetuity, you should just run. I mean, you need to own your music.
Yes.
And if you do, with a lot of indies, they own it for a small time, it reverts back to the owner after, say, 5-7 years.
Yeah.
Okay. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
Yeah. Own your music, I think that's good.
Also, two questions, I guess.
Okay.
The first one about the bylaws.
Yeah.
Basically, could a Swedish company just register with you guys if they had a USPO box, or how harsh are you guys on that?
This is on camera, so we should talk afterwards.
All right.
Sorry, boss.
No problem. Second question. You mentioned digital, and you mentioned what it's doing and what it's doing, mm-hmm. I guess, to independent labels and definitely independent artists.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think right now that you're forced to accept this status quo of the importance of digital, or is there work towards doing something else? Because like what you represent is something huge. A lot of labels, a lot of artists, a lot of content. Do you see a shift towards let's create something new? I'm not talking about a title. I'm talking about
like title the company or
yeah
okay
but not that
I think that if anybody is not accepting the fact that we're in a digital world, they're asleep. I mean, this is the facts. We live in a digital world. It's all music consumption. I mean, I think music's being consumed more than ever right now because we have so many options, so many platforms, which is exciting. And that's why I love Record Union, for example. They're letting these artists that would never have a chance 10 years ago. Back 10 years ago, you had to have a distributor or a major distributor or somebody that's gonna get your music out. Now, you pay a nominal fee, you have it on every DSP that's out there. That's amazing. It's a huge opportunity for artists. And I congratulate companies that take these risks and start companies that are giving artists empowerment. So yes, I do think we have to accept that we're in a digital world. Do we have to accept the rates at which these services are paying out our artists? Absolutely not. And that's what we're fighting for, because you look at it per stream plays fractions of pennies. I mean, fractions. I think Spotify is doing the best job in terms of fair payouts. Could it be better? Absolutely. And then there's the number one music consumption site known as YouTube, who's paying the least. And that's a very big problem. And that's, you know, we're fighting towards equitable terms and it's a fair market rate. I think artists should be, I don't think it should be seen as it's just content that people should be able to get. They need to respect the fact that these people put hours of their time, creativity, into giving consumers something to listen to. I think we need to go back to that, the days where, I mean, I grew up, I might not look it, but I'm 32, and I grew up buying cassette tapes, buying CDs, and when you didn't have a choice, you didn't hear like, oh, there's a single, I wanna go to Spotify and listen to that single. You had to buy an album and actually listen to an album, or you could press fast forward on the cassette tape and get to that song that you heard on the radio. But I think it goes back to that we need to respect music more than we do now, because it's, we have these giant tech companies who are building their platforms off creative content. They're making millions. Our artists are making pennies. Something's wrong with that. Yeah. That's got really deep there. Everybody really optimistic about the future of music? Who's got a lighter question? No, I'm just kidding. That was a great question. Seriously. Sure.
I might put you in an uncomfortable situation at the moment, but I noticed on the video...
I didn't fly over here to have the easy street.
I noticed on the video of your awards that you had only one female winner. How do you
trust
that?
Me, this is something that... our office is 50-50. We have 3 males, 3 females. We just hired another guy, so it tilted back to the male side. But this is a topic. Portia Sabin, who's the president of Kill Rockstar, who hosted the award show, has always voiced that, and we're the same way. We need more women in this business. I absolutely, it is a male-dominated business, and I don't see why. I know plenty of female executives who are brilliant, more brilliant than I will ever be. Not that I'm saying I'm brilliant, but I think I'm just saying it's lopsided, and it should definitely change. I mean, there's amazing female artists. There are amazing female executives, such as Stephanie Alexa from A2O, who's on our board. She's one of the smartest individuals I've met.
How does your organization work with bringing more females into the, like?
There's an organization called Women in Music, and Jen Massé, our senior director, she works closely with them. I don't per se, but I mean, I have to deal with 390 labels on a daily basis. It gets a little busy. But to answer your question, how do you change that? I think that's a systematic, that's a society question. And I think it goes way beyond just the music business. I think it's every industry.
Thank you.
I'm a feminist, if you want to know. I'm serious. Anybody else?
I could see that in America you have, I think the indie culture is very strong there.
Absolutely.
Like, and the labels, like in the conference, that people is really passionate on that. And I think like the managers in the labels, it's not like a job that they have been jumping from place to place, but it's like they have been there for like, they are dinosaurs that
right.
Doing, in a good sense, isn't it, Dave? Is that right?
No, I mean, there's some older fellows at indie labels, and why would they leave their cush setup, right?
It's like a lifestyle, is that right?
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, look, I've been in the major label system, and you're a cog in the machine. It cycles out, that they're shrinking. The staff size is shrinking. There's no stability. When you go to an indie label, when you're super passionate about your artist and you're not signing artists just to have something in the pipeline, so in 3 months you have something to release, it's a whole different ballgame. And why would you leave something when you get to work with artists that not only do you personally love, but you love their music and you truly believe in their music, and you're going to pour every hour of your day into getting their music out there to the public? I think it's, I think when you have a good thing, there's no need to leave. Yeah.
Do you think that this is the, because apparently what I feel is that like the A&R process, it's very good.
Yeah.
Because like the casting, like the artists that you list now, it's like really impressive names. Do you think like the indie label, for being like so passionate in the product, this is the edge, like the difference that they have, or what would you attribute that's the main difference that they have to have like Taylor Swift and some other names coming from the indie side?
I think indie labels have the advantage because, I mean, I'm gonna put myself in the position of if I was an artist and I was looking at the roster of, say, I don't know, Sub Pop. I mean, the roster speaks for itself. Mass Appeal speaks for itself. You would want to associate yourself with those kind of artists. Whereas I think the biggest thing is that, you know, when you go to an independent label, you're going to get the time and attention that you need. And they're not going to see your band as a commodity. They're going to see you as part of a family, and they want to actually nurture you and see your band get to the level that you've always dreamed to be. I think this is, again, this is a personal opinion, but I don't think that's the case at a major label. I've worked in an A&R department at a major label, and yes, it's great. It's fun. The politics are not, and you can get really close to bands, and then the album tanks, see you later. There's no second chance, and that's a sad state. And I also think, but I think going back to what you're saying, I think the A&R process at these indie labels is way more fine-tuned, and it's not panic buys. I think when you see in the major label system, the word gets around, oh, Atlantic's putting a bid of this, Capitol's gonna bid this. You go in, you're like a panic offer, and you never know if that return's gonna come, and it's can be some really extreme money. But I think the A&R process is definitely more from the gut. As I see at a lot of majors, is a lot of it is metrics driven, and there's nothing wrong with that, because that definitely dictates, oh, they're getting 3 million streams in a week. They're reacting. I get it. That can also work on the independent side. And I think it has. I mean, you look at 300, for example, they have artists like Young Thug and Fetty Wap. Fetty Wap's Trap Queen was probably one of the biggest songs of this past year. And that, I think they found that off metrics, but it's an independent label. Did I answer your question?
Absolutely.
I think the jet lag's really starting to kick in right now. Maybe that I was like on a beach for 3 days and then I fly across the Atlantic. But I'm happy to answer more questions. Anybody?
I was thinking about the difference of indie labels and majors, or what do you call it, for a songwriter. So what is the actual, what is the pitch as an indie label for a songwriter?
Well, that goes more to publishing. You know, we're trying to branch out into that area. We have a few publishers who are associate members, but considering we are a trade organization that was founded on independent labels, there's another association that handles publishers. But there are some amazing indie publishers out there right now. Downtown Music is, I think, one of the most fantastic publishers in America. Songs has, I mean, you name it, they have Diplo, they have DJ Mustard, they're endless.
But are you then saying that sort of the network of indies is as big as sort of the majors?
Collectively, I would say so. Yes, collectively, but not on an individual basis. I mean, we're talking about labels like Interscope who have a 7% market share. That's incredible. That's lucrative. But in terms of for the songwriter, I think it all stems back, whether you're a songwriter, you're a band, you're a producer, I think it goes back to relationships. And I think, you know, if you want to sign a publishing deal with an indie publisher who's actually going to give you the time and attention that you deserve, rather than going to say sign for Universal Publishing and you'll be one of thousands upon thousands of songwriters, you might not get the attention that you need.
Right, but I guess they would have more artists to sort of give your songs to.
True, but the thing is, you don't necessarily, a songwriter can pitch your song to anybody. It doesn't matter if it's a major, if it's an indie, that's totally up to you and up to your publisher pitching it.
Yeah, thank you.
No, I feel, did I answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. Sure. Absolutely not. I've worked on both sides, and I think it's all circumstantial. If you're a massive pop star, you need the major label. Sometimes you need that major label muscle. You need that radio arm, that sales, that marketing arm. But with the amount of platforms that are available today, you can get as much work done at an indie as you can a major. And I think you'll have a lot more creative freedom, and you'll have a lot better deal terms. I'm pretty sure if you A-B'd a major label contract compared to an indie, you'll see it leans way more favorable in the artist's favor on an indie side than at a major. Again, just my two cents, and I'm definitely biased. Anybody else? No?
I have one.
You have a question?
In terms of the future of indies and majors, do you have any ideas? Like, do you think that the indies will take over the majors, or like everything will blend together, or what do you think?
I would like to see it not so much as a competition, more as a music business where we can all work together. I think if we create synergy between the majors and the indies, we can get a lot more done than if we're fighting against each other. And especially in America, it's been very much the labels versus the publishers. And I'd like to see that battle go away as well, because it's a zero-sum game if we keep doing this. I think if we work collectively, we're going to see a much healthier landscape, and the returns for both the labels and the artists are going to be better than ever. I'm optimistic. I mean, look at the amount of music that's being put out today. It's on a creative level, it's astonishing. There's music that every day I wake up and it fucks me up. I'm just like, oh my God, that is amazing. Yeah. That's what you want from music. You know, you want that feeling of, wow, I can still get excited. You think you've heard it all after 32 years of music, right? No, every day somebody's pushing the boundaries more and more, collaborations that are happening that you would have never expected in the past. And I think if we work together, we're going to be in a much better place. I don't want to I'd rather it not be a indie versus major. I'd rather us combine forces, because what's wrong, it's not the majors or the indies. It's the laws that we're stuck in that are dated back before the age of the internet. You know, the DMCA, there's work to be done, and there's a lot wrong with the lawmaking in terms of our music business, and we have to correct that. And that's a big part of what A2IM is trying to do. And it's not only just for the indies, it's for everybody.
Yeah, that's great. That's awesome. Thank you so much.
Thank you.